بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. This is part 11 of our series on history of Palestine. Previously, we discussed the first battles that occurred between the Muslims and the Romans, beginning with the army of Usama at the beginning of the Khalifat of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and thereafter the four armies that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent, and the armies also that he sent to Persia. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu in his time opened two fronts. He fought two superpowers of the time, both the Romans and the Persians at the same time. And the Romans and the Persians, in terms of their economics, their numbers, their technology, the age of their empire, were far superior to the Muslims in all aspects. On paper, it would seem impossible for the Muslims to fight one of these forces. However, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent armies to both the Persians and the Romans. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was successful. He beat the Persians in Al-Qadisiyah and broke their backs. And as we will see today, the Romans, not long after that, suffered the same fate as the Persians. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent his four armies to the Levant, to the Roman lands at that time, Syria and its surroundings. And we said that a battle occurred, and this battle was the first major battle between the Muslims and the Romans, the Battle of Ajnadin, which was close to the city of Ramla current day. And this battle marks the first major victory of the Muslims over the Romans. And this battle occurred towards the end of the life of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And as we said, Khalid ibn al-Walid was in charge of the armies. He came and he united the armies under one rule, and he led on the first day. And when they saw nobody could lead like Khalid, they left him to lead, and the Muslims were victorious at Ajnadin. And this news reached Medina while Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was on his deathbed. May Allah be pleased with him. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu passed away at the end of this battle. And if you look at his khilafah, in 2.5 years, what he achieved was something that can only be described as a blessing from God, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The revolt of the apostate Arabs. He cleaned up the Arabian Peninsula once again after coming back to only Medina. He sent the army of Usama forth that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam commanded go forth towards the Romans. He opened up France against the Persians and against the Romans, the two superpowers of the time, and he was successful in all his battles despite the discrepancy in terms of numbers, small numbers, fractions compared to the Romans and the Persians, despite the economic disparities, despite their empires being empires which were thousands of years old, despite them ruling over large areas of land, despite them having experience in terms of battle and warfare and fighting on those lands, Abu Bakr, even with all of that, was successful. And we'll see why, inshallah, shortly, why were they successful? It was because they believed in the truth, and they believed that they were fighting with Allah and for Allah. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory over those who came in their way. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu passes, and Umar ibn al-Khattab then assumes the khilafah, the successorship, in the year 13 years after the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam from Mecca to Medina. And the first order of affair concerning the armies in Syria and its surroundings is that Umar radiallahu anhu removes Khalid ibn al-Walid from leadership. And the reason for this is not what many claim, that there were problems between Umar and Khalid and they did not like each other. But Umar ibn al-Khattab saw what was happening to the Muslims, so he did this to renew their faith. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu put his trust in Khalid in a lot of matters. With the apostates, Abu Khalid led the armies in Yamama, the biggest battles that happened between the Muslims and the apostates at Yamama with Musaylima al-Kadhab. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent Khalid to the lands of the Persians, and he opened up most of the lands and he paved the way for the victories. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, after that, when he saw problems occurring in the Levant and its surroundings, he sent for Khalid to move from Persia to the Levant. So he put his trust in Khalid, and rightly so. Khalid was a man known for his military prowess and his intelligence when it came to these matters. But what had occurred is that the Muslims now started feeling that if Khalid leads, we will win. If Khalid is in the army, we will win. Whatever Khalid says, that will lead to our strength and our success. And Umar radiallahu anhu didn't like this. Because it is not because of Khalid that they won, radiallahu anhum jami'an. It is because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the iman that Khalid had. The belief that he had that Allah is with him. That is why they won. So Umar wanted to show them whether Khalid is leading or he is not leading. Allah is the one who gives victory, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the decider, not Khalid. So he replaced Khalid with Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn al-Jarrah, radiallahu anhu. And Khalid ibn al-Walid remained with the armies, but he was not the supreme leader over these armies. The leadership had moved to Abu Ubaidah. During this time, after the Battle of Ajnadin, the army split into their groups. And Shurahbil ibn Hasana was one of the leaders of the four armies with Yazid ibn Muawiyah and Amr ibn al-As and Abu Ubaidah. Shurahbil was in the north of the Levant, and there he began with certain skirmishes and campaigns against the Romans. And troops started to gather at Baalbek in Lebanon, current day, to fight him. Because of these skirmishes in the north, the Romans who inhabited, the soldiers who inhabited many cities in that area, started moving out of that area and gathering a force in a place called Baysan. Khalid ibn al-Walid, when he realized that this force is gathering, he realized that Baysan is not an area where forces should gather. It's not safe for the Romans. And he realized that this move on the part of the Romans was strategically incorrect. So he called for the armies and he asked Abu Ubaidah that they attack the Romans at Baysan. And the Muslims managed to gather together 26,000. Like we said, the Muslim army was between 34 and 39,000 at most at that time. 26,000 men came together, and the Muslims under the leadership of Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn al-Jarrah, faced the Romans, which were 50,000, and according to some estimates, 80,000. So 26,000 Muslims versus 50,000, double. They were outnumbered 2-1, and they faced them at Baysan. And the Muslims are victorious. At this battle, they killed 10,000 Romans and the remainder fled. After this battle, the Muslims now had a strong foothold in Sham, in the Levant, because they had won two great battles against the Romans. And how does this tie up with our story of Palestine? It ties up because these lands all lead to Palestine. And these lands, including Palestine, this area is controlled by the Romans. So eventually it leads to Palestine, as we will see in the coming lectures. The Muslims started looking at the Roman movement and the strategies that they were using and where were they gathering. And they found that the stronghold of the Romans was the city of Damascus. This was the strongest city and the key to opening up the Levant. So the Muslims gathered again and the armies regrouped, and they laid siege to the city of Damascus. So this is essentially 10 months after Ajnadin. Ajnadin occurred, the first battle, 6 months later. We said Baysan happened, and Baysan is an area which is west of the Jordan River, near to Busra in current day. And thereafter, the Muslim laid siege to Damascus, and 4 months later, Damascus falls. So in 10 months, they achieved a lot. They won three major battles and controlled three strong points, the biggest of them being the city of Damascus. And this was in the year 14 AH in Rajab. After the fall of Damascus, other big centers began to fall. Baalbek fell also. Other cities began to crumble and fall and change now into to the favor of the Muslims because of the fall of Damascus. Heraclius at this point, and this is something that's just a coincidence, when these events happened in this 10-month period, Heraclius was in Jerusalem, in Elia. And Heraclius would visit Jerusalem every year to do pilgrimage, thanking God for his victory over the Persians, because Jerusalem was a sacred city to Heraclius. He was a Christian. So he would do pilgrimage to Jerusalem every year, thanking God for his victory over the Persians. Like we mentioned before, the Persians beat them, and this was in the revealed in the Quran in the beginning of Surah Ar-Rum. So when the Muslims won at Ramla at Ajnadin, he left Damascus and moved. He left Jerusalem and moved to Damascus. And then the Muslims won at Baysan, he left Damascus and moved to Hims. And the Muslims laid siege to Damascus, he left Hims and he moved to Antakya, which is a city on the Syria-Turkey border. So he kept moving north away from these battles. And this started worrying him now that he was losing his lands. And it was something that wasn't foreseen, because the Muslims' armies, like I said before, the armies were not capable in any sort or form on paper to achieve what they achieved. This was all through the divine intervention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the iman that these armies had in their strength and in their creator. So these events, they weighed heavy on him, and he decided now that he needs to take a strong stand. So he started gathering troops to Antakya, and he wanted to control the battles from this region, which was on the border of Turkey and Syria. He gathered 200,000 men. And news reached Abu Ubaidah, Amr ibn al-Jarrah, about this large army that is gathered now in Antakya, and it is still growing in number. The Muslims were only between 34 and 39,000, and maybe less because of the losses that they might have incurred upon themselves during the skirmishes and battles that were ongoing. Abu Ubaidah sends a letter to Umar ibn al-Khattab after hearing about this massive force of 200,000 men that are gathering and still growing. And he asked Umar ibn al-Khattab, and I just mentioned a few words what was said in the letter. He says, Al-ajal, al-ajal, ya amir al-mu'minin. He tells him, hurry, hurry, O commander of the faithful. Bir-rijali ba'da al-rijal. By sending men after men, meaning aid us with men. Wa illa, and if you don't, fahtasib أنفس المسلمين إنهم أقاموا. Then take into account the souls of the believers if they have to stand fast. Meaning that if the Muslims have to stand fast against this great strong army that is coming, we will lose our lives. واحتسب دينهم إنهم فروا. And take into account their religion if they flee. Because if they flee, they lose their religion. They is fleeing from the battlefield. فقد جاءهم ما لا قبل لهم به. Because what has come to them, to the Muslims, is a force that they have no power over. They cannot go in any direction to avoid this force. Illa an yumiddahum Allahu bi malaikatihi aw bi ghiyathin min 'indi. Except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aids them with his angels or with help from himself. Wassalamu alaykum, and peace be upon you. Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he received this letter, he wept. And he did not weep because he was afraid of the Romans, but he wept because of the state of the Muslims. He wanted to remind them again what gave them strength. It was not their numbers, nor their military prowess, nor the equipment that they held, swords and shields and horses, none of that. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gave them victory and who gave them strength. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, and he mentioned this to Bani Israel, كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله. How many a time has a small force overpowered a greater force? بإذن الله, with the permission of Allah. والله مع الصابرين, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are patient. So Umar ibn al-Khattab writes back to Khalid, and with him he sends 1,000 men under the leadership of Sa'id ibn Amir. So he sends a letter and 1,000 men, and the letter is equivalent or more greater than had he sent hundreds of thousands of men, because the words that he conveys into the armies bring back to them their faith and their strength in themselves and in their Lord. He sent 1,000 men with Sa'id ibn Amir, and he wrote, do not fear their numbers, addressing Abu Ubaidah and the army, telling them, do not fear the numbers of the Romans, for verily Allah is free of them. Allah has nothing to do with them. Allah is bari, free of them. And whoever Allah has abandoned, it is only befitting that no might in strength or numbers can aid them. If Allah has abandoned you, your might, your strength, your numbers, your wealth, nothing can help you. And do not fear if the believers are few in number. And now he addresses the Muslims. Don't fear your small numbers. If you are few in number, do not be afraid. For verily few will reign over many if Allah is with them. If you are few, remember that Allah is with you. And never are those whom with them is Allah few. And if you are few, but Allah is with you, you are not few, you are many, you are great. So when they received this letter from Umar, it rejuvenated them, and thereafter they felt no fear. 1,000 men added was nothing compared to an army of 200,000 and still growing. So after this letter, Abu Ubaidah gathers his generals and his council, and they start discussing strategy to face the Romans. The first strategy that was suggested was that the Muslims encamp on the Arabian Peninsula. And at this time they were south of Damascus. This was where all the men were gathered. And the first suggestion was that they move the armies and draw the Romans towards the Arabian Peninsula or on the borders of the Arabian Peninsula, so that if by chance they cannot overpower the Romans, they are able to flee safely into the desert, and the Romans will not be able to fight them in the desert and not be able to follow them back. And they will be able to flee safely back to Al-Madinah. Khalid ibn al-Walid, that's why he's great. Khalid ibn al-Walid, when he heard this, he said, never flee. He smelt the fear in those who were suggesting that they encamp on the Arabian, on the borders of the Arabian Peninsula. Never flee. Why did Khalid say never flee? Not because he's reckless or he doesn't understand the magnitude of the situation. It is because Khalid has complete faith that Allah will give them victory. And this is why Abu Bakr relied on Khalid so much. Because Khalid, not military prowess or strength, gave him victory. It is his faith that gave him victory. Look what he says. He says to them, Ara wallahi, I see by Allah, in kunna nuqatilu bil kathrati wal adad, that verily, if we were fighting based on our numbers, hum aktharu minna, then they are more than us, wa aqwa minna, and more powerful than us, wa ma lana bihim idhan taqa, and in this case we have no power over them. So if you look at our numbers, they're much more than us, they outnumber us, and they are more powerful than us. They're superior, so we have no power over them. And then he tells them, وَإِن كُنَّا نُقَاتِلُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ, but if we are fighting them with Allah, وَلِلَّهِ, and for Allah, فَمَا أَرَى أَنَّ جَمَاعَتَهُمْ وَلَوْ كَانُوا أَهْلَ الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا أَنَّا تُغْنِ عَنْهُمْ شَيْئًا, then I do not see that their group, even if they were aided with all of mankind, would help them in any way, not numbers, not power, not economics. Why? Because we are fighting them with Allah and for Allah. Their numbers, even if it were the people of the earth, all of them had to come together, they would not defeat us. So Khalid addressed them with these words. Abu Ubaidah, when he heard these words, he realized that what is Khalid is saying is correct. So he took counsel from Khalid and he asked Khalid, what shall we do? What strategies shall we employ? What should we do? So Khalid radiallahu anhu, known for his strategy, known for his military prowess, known for his strength in these matters, tells Abu Ubaidah that he is the supreme leader. But he tells Abu Ubaidah, give me control over the army. And he tells Abu Ubaidah, if you ask him for my counsel, then will you listen? So Abu Ubaidah, knowing Khalid, said, I will listen. So he says, give me control of the army and you will control all the forces, meaning all the armies. But this particular army that we have here, you are the leader of what is happening in the Levant. But this particular army, I need power over it so that I can do as I see fit. Abu Ubaidah gives him that. And Khalid thereafter takes control of these forces and he employs a plan. What was his plan? Firstly, the area that he chose is known as Yarmouk. This area is between Syria, Palestine and Jordan. And this is from his insight and his skill. This area is a hilly area. And the entrance to this area can only be entered through narrow pathways. So the Roman army there was drawn into these narrow pathways, and all this great number could not enter at one time. All of them could not enter at one time, so it allowed the Muslims to fight them in batches. So he drew them into this land, the first strategy. Secondly, he positioned himself in such a way that if the Romans enter, their backs would then face hills and cliffs that they could fall over if they had to retreat or if the Muslims could push them. The third thing, he split the Muslims into 39 battalions. Each battalion, he put leaders of the tribes and tribes, Arab tribes, into these battalions. And then he spoke to them and said, let not the disbelievers attack us through you all. Meaning he used tribalism to say that if they attack us through you all, your tribe is failing, the Muslims. So use a strategy of tribalism to make them strong and say that none of them would want to take upon themselves blame or be a cause for blame upon their own tribes. And thereafter, he appointed to the right of the wing of the army Mu'adh ibn Jabal and to the left Kibath ibn Asham, and he took control of the cavalry and the infantry were left in the control of Hashim ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhum jami'an. So Khalid ibn al-Walid then faced the Romans at Yarmouk, and he was victorious in this battle. And we should remember that these are the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every Muslim should remember this day. On 15th Rajab, in the year 15 AH, Khalid ibn al-Walid with the Muslims in the Khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab broke the back of the Romans. The Roman Empire, 1,200 years old, was broken by an empire that is only 15 years old. They broke the back of the Romans at Yarmouk. 200,000 men, 130,000 perished, facing an army of just 34,000. 90,000 Romans fell to their deaths. 40,000 were killed, and 70,000 flee to the cities or other cities to garrison in after that. Heraclius, after this, leaves Antakya and goes to his lands in Europe and forgets about Sham forever. And he mentions this when he comes onto a hilltop that looks over Syria. He used to say when he would come for pilgrimage, Salamun alayki ya Suriya, Salamun ya'udu ilayki ba'dahin. He would say, peace be upon you, O Syria. Peace and greetings that will return to you after a while, whenever he was leaving, because he knew he would be coming back. This time, when he ascended to this hillock, he said, Salamun alayki ya Suriya, peace and greetings upon you, O Syria. Salamul Mufariq, greetings of somebody who is leaving. La awdata laki ba'd al-an, there is no return to you after this time. So he knew that he had lost the land of the Levant, Syria and its surroundings, and the Muslims rejoiced in their lands. And after that, it was easy that they started opening up the rest of the cities in the Levant, cleanup work. Abu Ubaidah appointed his governors and generals to take part in different skirmishes. He put Yazid and Muawiyah, the sons of Abu Sufyan, over Damascus. And from there, they opened up Lebanon. And Shurahbil ibn Hassanah was made to rule over Jordan. And he opened up Jordan, and the historians say with ease. All the cities fell with ease. And Abu Ubaidah and Khalid ibn al-Walid headed to Hims. And lastly, Amr ibn al-As headed towards Palestine, and inshallah we'll speak about this great Sahabi Amr ibn al-As and his skirmishes and battles in Palestine and what took place after that with the treaty between Umar ibn al-Khattab and the people of Jerusalem in our next lecture. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.